Welcome to EPG Paathshala. Myself Dr. Kumari Vandana, and today I am going to present a module under paper number 3, that is Thermodynamics of Living System and Bioenergetics. Today the module is its number is 223, and the topic of the module is Thermodynamics of Heart and Phonocardiography. Firstly, we will go with the objectives of the module, which includes introduction, thermodynamics and the cardiac cycle, heart sounds, measurement of heart sounds, and finally we will take the summary of the whole module. First, we will start with the introduction to heart. The heart beats every day till the end of our lives. It can be seen as a pump consisting of the left side of the left heart, and the right side of the right heart. They are connected in series by two independent circulatory systems, the pulmonary circulation and the systemic circulation. The left-sided heart pumps blood through the systemic circulation, and the right-sided heart pumps blood through the pulmonary circulation. Each side of the heart has two chambers, the atrium and ventricles. They are innervated, and the pacemaker activity of the heart makes it contract and relax in a regular fashion. The contraction and relaxation are called systole and diastole respectively, and they are well timed in the atrium and the ventricles. So when the atrium is contracting, the ventricle is relaxed, and when the ventricle is contracting, the atria is relaxed. With every systole and diastole, the dynamics of blood circulation inside the chamber of the heart changes. The atrium receives and stores blood during the ventricle contraction, and the blood flow from the atrium to the ventricle during the ventricular relaxation. The right side of the heart is mainly involved in pulmonary circulation, wherein the right ventricle pushes blood through the blood vessels of the lungs. The left side of the heart is involved in systemic circulation, wherein the left ventricle pumps blood to all other parts of the body via the aorta, arteries and arterioles. The main function of the circulation of the body blood is to carry nutrients and supply oxygen to the tissues. Once inside the cell, an oxygen and nutrients react chemically and release energy. This energy is used by the cell, leading to the formation of water and carbon dioxide. It is disposed of by the cells in the blood. It leads to decrease in concentration of oxygen in the blood, and the concentration of carbon dioxide increases as the blood flows through the systemic circulation. In pulmonary circulation, oxygen from the pulmonary alveoli is added to blood, whereas carbon dioxide comes out from the blood and gets diffused into the pulmonary alveoli. We later on exhale this CO2. Now, after picking up the fresh oxygen, it flows from the pulmonary circulation to the left side of the heart. There it fills left ventricle, and now a new cycle continues. In this figure we have seen the QL segment shows the cardiac output of the left heart, QP shows the blood flow from the pulmonary circulation, QR shows the cardiac output of the right heart, and the QS shows the venous return, that is the blood flow from the systemic circulation. The unidirectional flow is mainly mediated by a well organized system of walls shown in the figure 1. In a normal steady state, the blood flow is the same throughout the system. That is, the QL segment is equal to QR is equal to QP is equal to QS is equal to Q. The cardiac output is the amount of blood pumped by heart per minute. In ventricles, it is given by cardiac output is equal to stroke volume into heart rate. The mean arterial pressure in the systemic circulation is given approximately by PMAP is equal to PDAP plus P sap minus P dap upon 3. That is where the PM map is the mean arterial pressure, P dap is the diastolic arterial pressure, and the P sap is the systolic arterial pressure. With every beat, the ventricle pump out blood. The left side of the ventricle pumps blood into the systemic circulation. The blood at the systemic end is already in a state of pressure, that is PSP. As the blood flows through the systemic circulation, it ends in a venous system. The pressure at the venous system is low, marked as PVP. The venous return is shown by VR. Systemic vascular resistance can be seen by RS is equal to PSP minus PVP upon VR. The cardiac cycle. Now we are going with the start with the cardiac cycle. The living cell obeys, must obey the laws of thermodynamics. As the first law, so equivalence between various forms of energy and also source, the energy is converted from one form to the other, thus maintaining the overall energy as constant value for any given system. The first law can be expressed mathematically as delta H is equal to delta G plus U. The first law expressed mathematically as expression delta H is equal to delta G plus U, where H, delta H is the total energy of the thermodynamic system, delta G is the amount of free energy that can be transformed into work, and delta U is the change of internal energy. The energy derived to perform the mechanical work done by the heart is mainly coming from the high energy bonds of ATP. The prime source of energy for heart muscles is the chemical energy that is derived from the carbohydrate and fatty acid from the food that we eat. A heart can be equated with a mechanical pump. In a mechanical pump, the ability of the pump to propel the fluids via the channel can be seen as an external work. In heart, the work done is described as pressure multiplied by volume. In fluids, the force into distance is equivalent to pressure and volume. Now, with every beat, the amount of blood ejected by the left ventricle is the stroke volume. And as the ventricle is pumping against the pressure, the amount of work done is the stroke volume of the left ventricle. It is equivalent to the pressure volume curve of the left ventricle. As the ventricle is pumping blood to maintain a column of blood to flow through the vessels, the external work also involves the kinetic work, and the rest is dissipated as heat. In thermodynamics, we study the pressure volume curve to study the fluid system, and the area under the pressure volume loop depicts the amount of work done. Let's see the figure 2 and the 3. In the figure 2 shows a pressure into volume diagram. In thermodynamics, it is used to describe a thermal cycle that is present in a pressure and volume system. The 1 source the expansion, workout, 2 source the heat in, the combustion, 3 source the compression, that is work in, and 4 source the heat out, the exhaust. In figure 3, we have seen the cardiac cycle of left ventricle. Initially, when the electrical impulses passes from the AV node to the SA node, the wave of depolarization passes all over the ventricles via the bundle of His and initiate contraction. During this, the ventricle contracts. When the ventricle contracts, the valvular system of the ventricle is closed from the other channel like an atrium, and also the semilunar valves, which prevent the blood to flow to the aorta, is also closed. Thus, ventricle attains a closed chamber-like structure. With the wave of depolarization passing via ventricles, the pressure increases but the volume remains the same. That is an isovolumic contraction. As the pressure inside the ventricle gradually increases more than what the semilunar wall can contain, the blood gushes out by the ejection phase. As the blood has moved out of the ventricles, the pressure inside it reduces, but the values are still closed, and the ventricle still assumes a closed chamber like a structure. Slowly the ventricle relaxes with a constant amount of blood inside it. That is isovolumic relaxation. After the relaxation, the pressure inside the atrium gradually increases and becomes more than that of ventricles. So there is filling of blood from the atrium into the ventricles. That is the filling phase. In the diagram, P represents the pressure, the SW represents the stroke work, V is the velocity, and SV is the stroke volume, and M represents the mass. The cardiac cycle consists of both mechanical event and electrical event, with electrical event preceding the mechanical one. If we draw an analogy between a steam engine and the pumping heart, we can see that the steam engine is a system that converts heat or the thermal energy into mechanical energy, whereas the heart uses substrate and converts the chemical energy into mechanical work. This work is done to pump blood into the high pressure circulation. To perform work, the heart muscle consumes oxygen. There are 2 types of work done that must be considered while talking about oxygen consumption: the internal work and the external work done. The heart uses large amount of potential energy to perform the internal work. That includes energy to overcome inertia of elastic and viscous elements. The energy used up during the internal work increases the heat of system, which later on leads to failure of the system. Now, carbon dioxide and oxygen utilization. There is a relationship between cardiac output and heart rate. As it is seen that the respiratory rate is associated with oxygen consumption. So, there is a relationship between cardiac output and oxygen consumption. It was Fick who first introduced the concept and devised a mathematical equation. The cardiac output is equal to Q into oxygen O2PV minus O2PA, whereas U is the cardiac output, Q is the rate of oxygen consumption, O2PV the oxygen concentration in the pulmonary veins, and O2PA that oxygen concentration in the pulmonary arterial blood. This equation helps us to calculate the cardiac output in an intact human being. Now, the cardiac efficiency. The idea of efficiency was developed in early 19th century with the development of steam engine. Total energy output of system used to be less than the amount of energy input. The majority of energy was used up in the form of friction and heat. With the advent of science, the efficiency of machine improvised, but it is not possible for the machines to give 100% efficiency. Resembling very closely with the mechanical engines, our heart also uses high concentrated energy for food sources. To improve the efficiency of a machine, the energy must be readily available and the fuel sources must be highly compact with a very high calorific value. Our body has also devised such an efficient system through the evolution process. The heart has very rich supply of capillaries to aid the delivery of blood and thus oxygen efficiently. Under most of the circumstances, the heart uses the high energy bond from the fatty acid and carbohydrates. And mind you, we are talking about the microscopic level. If we integrate the whole process, the results are mind-blowing in the macroscopic level. The efficiency of the heart is given by efficiency is equal to pressure volume work divided by the oxygen utilization. The efficiency of the heart to pump blood to meet the oxygen requirement is around 15-25% at resting cardiac output. Through the evolutionary process, this efficiency is maintained across all the mammals. This leads to fact that larger the mammal, greater will be its metabolism and greater will be the amount of external work that it can perform. The efficiency of heart increases with a greater stroke volume and a smaller heart rate. But if the heart rate increases, the internal work done also by the heart muscle will be more. The efficiency of heart increases with the greater stroke volume and a smaller heart rate. But if the heart rate increases, the internal work done by the heart muscles will be more. Why? Because with every beat, the wall of heart have to collapse, and to make it happen, the muscles have to overcome friction and viscosity with a substantial amount of energy expelled as heat. Large ventricle also contribute to the efficiency of heart. Larger the ventricle, more is the internal work done to pump out blood by the muscle cells and more is the oxygen consumption. This leads to a decrease in mechanical efficiency of the heart. In pathophysiological cases like congestive heart failure, ventricular myopathies, ventricular hypertrophies, etc., the efficiency of heart decreases. As the progression of disease is associated with efficiency, so in a case of machine, we do servicing regularly to maintain an optimum output and keep it cost effective. In the same way, to maintain our heart in optimal working condition, we must exercise regularly and give our body healthy diet. Now we are going to study about the entropy and heart. The second law of thermodynamics is mathematically expressed as delta S upon delta T is greater than or equals to zero, where delta S is the increase in entropy and delta T is the time. It can be deduced from the formula that the entropy is either equal to zero or more than that. The time is fundamental unit. This means the system will have increased entropy with increase in time. Entropy inside a structure is more, which involves more macroscopic structure that are randomly organized and moves independently. In heart, when the muscle contract in response to the action potential, some part of energy is not utilized to provide the output of propelling blood into the circulation. This leftover energy is dissipated at heat and is spread to the whole system. Gradually, the wear and tear of the system increases, and as we age, increase in time, the chaos and the randomness in the system increases, leading to deterioration of the system. In other words, it can be said that our heart becomes susceptible to more pathophysiological condition. In thermodynamics, we know that any physiological system will spontaneously approach equilibrium. This state is called the state of thermodynamic equilibrium or of maximum entropy. In this state, there is no net flow of energy or matter, no unbalanced driving forces or phase changes with the system. The cardiac cycle can be seen as a quasi-reversible process. It is very important that we must try to fully understand the components taking part in entropy generation. The most important factor is the friction. The major chunk of internal work done is to overcome friction. The friction lies at macroscopic and macroscopic level. Macroscopically, the various molecules are rough in three-dimensional space. They combine together to form various cardiac muscle fibers and the environment surrounding the blood flow inside the muscle. When the heart is pumping, it is doing work against the pressure. The friction between the various components like the muscle fibers, the blood cells, striking of the blood against the blood vessels, closure of valves, etc. lead to generation of heat and increase at entropy. Now we are going to study about the sounds of the heart. Till now in the module, we have seen the different phases of the cardiac cycle. The blood is pumped out during systole and fills in the chamber during the diastole. The gushing of blood across various chambers produces vibration in the muscles and the changes in pressure leads to opening and closing of the valves. This leads to generation of heart sounds. The vibrations are picked up from various sides of the heart, amplified, heard and interpreted. The different types of sound show how healthy or diseased the heart is. There are four different heart sounds. The first heart sound S1, second heart sound S2, third heart sound S3 and fourth heart sound S4. Let us discuss each in details. Now we are going to study about the first heart sound S1. It marks the beginning of ventricular systole. Then the ventricular contraction, when the pressure builds up, the atrioventricular valves closes, making the ventricle closed compartment. During the ventricular contraction, when the pressure builds up, the atrioventricular valves closes, making a ventricular a closed compartment. There are two atrioventricular valves, mitral and the tricuspid. There is a difference between the closing time of two, which is called as a split. The delay between the closure of the tricuspid and the mitral valves is 20 to 30 milliseconds. The prolongation of this split is mainly pathological. The acoustic properties of S1 shows the myocardial contractile strength and the functioning of the atrioventricular valves. The closure of the valves create vibrations. The most compelling evidence indicates that the components result from the closure of the mitral and the tricuspid valves and the vibration sets up in the valve cups, chordae, papillary muscles and ventricular valves before aortic ejection. It is picked up best from the mitral area. It is the location on the chest that is in the fifth intercostal space. Now we are going to study about the second heart sound. The closure of the semilunar valves produces this sound. There are two semilunar valves, aortic and the pulmonary. As the ventricular relaxes after the systole, the blood that is pumped into the aorta and the pulmonary veins exert a pressure which is more than pressure inside ventricles. As a result, they fall back, thereby causing the closure of the valves. As the pressure in the aorta is more than the pulmonary artery, the aortic valve closes before the pulmonary valves, thus producing a split in the second heart sound. The split is physiological and usually accentuates. The split is physiological and usually accentuates during inspiration. The S2 has a higher frequency than S1. The vibrations are picked up from the second intercostal space. The left second intercostal area on the left side of the sternum picks up the pulmonary valve vibration, whereas the right side picks up the aortic valve vibration. These areas are respectively called as pulmonary and aortic area. Now we are going to study the third heart sound, the S3. It is mainly seen in the rapid filling phase of the diastole. The main reason for the genesis of the third sound is the vibration set in the ventricles due to the sudden expansion of the ventricles during the rapid filling of blood. Its presence is normal in some normal healthy adult, but it is seen as important sign in heart failure patient. Its presence is normal in some normal healthy adults, but it is an important sign in heart failure patient. It is a low frequency sound. Now proceeding further, we go with the fourth heart sound, the S4. It is also a low frequency sound and found in the late diastole phase, just before the origin of the first heart sound. It is produced mainly by the vibrations generated in the expanding ventricles during the atrial contraction. It is mainly shows the ventricular distensibility. The fourth sound mainly shows the ventricular distensibility. In various pathological conditions, when the ventricles are stiff and are not able to distend, the atria has to contract extra hard to push blood. Thus sharply increasing the pressure. This result in a genesis of sharp fourth heart sound. The figure shows that the various heart sounds measured and its correlation with the ECG. In the next segment, we are going to study the measurements of heart sound. First, we go with the concept of volume conductor. The biological tissues separating the sources and recording electrodes are called the volume conductor. It plays a vital role in acquisition of signals. The generated action potential creates an electrical field in the surrounding space. Thus, the potential generated by the motor unit can also be detected at a distant location. The potential signals have to transfer through various media so as to reach the The generated action potential creates an electrical field in the surrounding space. Thus, the potential generated by the motor unit can also be detected at a distant location. The potential signals have to transfer through various mediums so as to reach the recording electrodes. Under static condition, the volume conductor obeys some relations. Delta J is equal to I, J is equal to sigma E, where J is the current density in the volume conductor, I is the current density in the source, sigma represents the conductivity of the media. If the media is homogeneous, conductivity does not depend on the site of recording. But if non-homogeneous, then the conductivity is across various media and distance of electrode and source play a crucial role. Now we are going to the various sets of the measurements of the heart sound. First, we go with the recording settings. This information is very crucial in biomedical research because the appropriate setting of the instrument will not only give a proper signal but also help in diagnosis of a disease. The two major challenges associated with an PCG recording devices are, first is the amplification. The biological signals are very weak in nature. They need a proper amplifier for the adequate amplification by the recording device. It brings the amplified signal to an appropriate range for display and analysis. The second problem is the filter. The main purpose is to remove any noise and it determines the frequency range to be maximally amplified. The second is a filter. The main purpose is to remove any noise and it determines the frequency range to be maximally amplified. A wrong filter selection may lead to the distortion and sometimes even disappearance of the signals. Now we are going to study the recording system. In any design of a PCG signal acquisition system, the three principal requirements must be kept in mind. The first is the frontal head. It interfaces the analog input signal to the analog to digital converter, that is the ADC. Second, it includes the voltage reference. It is an electronic device which maintains a constant voltage. The constant voltage is maintained regardless of the temperature changes, the load of the device, power supply variation, and the passage of time. The third includes the digital interface. It is the medium through which we interact with the computer. Interaction act be in form of auditory, visual and functional components. Touch of work. After studying the recording system, we are proceeding with the concept of noise. In electronics, the noise is an unwanted disturbance in an electrical signal. It varies greatly in electronic devices and it is produced by several different effects. To reduce noise, it is important to apply filters. The main functions of filters are to remove the unwanted signals and give a biologically important signal. Now, few points should be kept in mind by recording of a heard sound using the phonocartography. The first is that the recording should be made in a quiet room that is free from ambient or background noises, because the external disturbance like people talking, fans, ACs will produce disturbance in the phonocardiogram. Secondly, the most preferable position of the subject is a supine position. Third, the transducer must be placed on the bare chest without any clothing. The patient must remain still and ensure that he is not talking. For the transducer should be in full contact with the chest wall with gentle pressing. Fifth, no undue pressure should be given on the transducer on the chest wall because the heard sound may get distorted. We should also see that the hair on the chest wall should be shaved, plastered down before applying transducer so as to prevent any artifact. We should also ensure that the transducer must be placed in a different area of the chest, such as the mitral, pulmonary, aortic and tricuspid region. Now I am going to tell about the transducer placement. The transducer is placed at the aortic, pulmonary, mitral and tricuspid areas. Now the duration of the recording. A very common mistake people make is the duration of the recording. If the duration of the recording is too short, then it's inadequate for analysis, and if too long, then the problem with artifact will arise. So the ideal timing for recording is very important. In the table, the heard sounds, its frequency, duration and associated events have been described. So in the first heard sound, its frequency is 25 to 45 hertz and its duration is 0.15 seconds. And the associated event is the closure of atrioventricular valve and the onset of ventricular systole. The second heard sound, which is of 50 hertz frequency and duration is 0.12 second, it is associated with the closure of the semilunar valves and the onset of ventricular systole. In the third heard sound, which is of very low frequency and its duration is 0.1 second, it is associated with the first rapid filling phase of ventricular diastole. The fourth heard sound, whose frequency is below 20 hertz, and it is mainly associated with the last rapid filling phase of ventricular diastole due to atrial contraction. At last, we are going to summarize the whole module. In the above discussion, we learned about the thermodynamics of heart. The heart can be seen as a pump with four chambers. Each chamber enclosed by a particular valve, therefore maintaining a uniform one-directional flow. In a steady state, the blood flowing through the circulation remains constant. The heart passes by a series of events in a cardiac cycle, which can be equated with the thermodynamic model. The work done by the heart can be derived by the pressure volume curve. The mechanical efficiency of the heart is 15 to 25%, which is maintained throughout the mammalian class of species. The major portion of potential energy is lost while performing the internal work. With every beat, the heat dissipated increases. Thus, it can be seen as a quasi-reversible process. The mechanical activity of heart is preceded by the electrical activity, and it converts the chemical energy present inside the food into the mechanical work for pushing the blood into circulation. So in order to maintain a good and healthy heart, we must provide our body with good food and exercise. The phonocardiography is a recording of heart sound by using a cardiac microphone. The various sounds are produced by vibration in the musculature of heart. The vibrations are picked up by transducer from various locations of the chest wall. The second heart sound is of 50 Hz, whereas the first heart sound is of 25 to 45 Hz. The abnormal heart sounds are called as murmur and signify the pathological state of the heart. Thank you.